Hello, you happy, wonderful people. It is a wonderful Thursday afternoon because it stopped raining finally here. So you would have all heard a lot of rain in the background, I'm sure, had it not done that. So who have we got? We've got the normal guys are on. So Jerry, YouTube Jerry is on. Earl's on. Andrew's on. Barry's on. Who else? Jeff's on again. That's cool. We're not calling a register. Don't worry. You don't have to turn up live. So let's get started for today. First thing to talk about before we even get into Capture One, for those of you that have a vague interest in a lot of the medium format stuff that I do, tomorrow there are two webinars. We're actually doing it live twice, which is going to be interesting, with Phase One. So if you want to see how we actually shoot, how we capture, and the switch that I made earlier from XF, which is the let's call it more commercial or studio based camera system from Phase One, across to XT, which is the more landscape orientated one. That's what we're going to talk about tomorrow with Drew live. So that's at 10 o'clock in the UK or 7 o'clock in the afternoon or in the evening UK. But you have to go across to a link to register. I did try and copy the link onto this page, but the link unfortunately is about 3 million characters long. So instead, if you go into the comment bit, you will find under details for this video the link to go and register. But you have to register to see it. So if you want to have a look at behind the scenes of what we've been doing for the last 6 months, that's the way to do it. So on to Capture One. We're going to spend the next hour going through Capture One. The current version still is build 13.1.3. So that is the up-to-date, active, let's call it stable version that's out there. Of course, we're in beta time, so there's a lot of talk about version 21. We're not going to go into that today in today's session. That we'll explore a bit more when version 21 is finally released. So just to make sure you're able to follow along with this session, make sure you're up to date. So 13.1.3 or 20.1.3 as it's marketed as. If you don't have Phase One, or sorry, Capture One at all, then make sure that you download the free trial. So it's completely free, 30 days, fully functional, no limits. Have a look at it that way. If you do have Capture One, then there are deals at the moment that include the version 21 upgrade. If you're not on version 13 or 20, as it is. But failing that, hopefully you're all on the latest version. So let's have a look at some pictures. And I said last time we're going to start with one of Ernst's shots. We are going to do that. In today's session, we're also going to cover round tripping to an HDR plugin. Now, my opinion on HDR is probably different to many other people's opinions on HDR, but for the sake of completeness, we'll go right the way through from editing the RAWs into the plugin and then back out again, back into Capture One in a second in another image. So let's have a look. It's got a really cool picture of a foggy forest. That is not a continuous cough. Let's just be very clear. So let's look at the first things we're going to do. So in Capture One, obviously, just quick reminder, we've got all these tabs along the top left-hand side. Some people prefer it on the right. So if I go to View, Customize Tools, and say Place Right, to some people that feels more familiar. To me, that feels a bit awkward because I've been using Capture One the other way for since I started using it, to be fair. So I have mine to the left. Browser, you can also have on the right or on the bottom, up to you, or you can fill the screen. But the first thing we're going to do with any image that we bring into Capture One is go to this lens correction tab. If it's got the correct lens that you shot the image with, then it should pop up here. If it doesn't, it may say manufacturer profile, which means your camera has embedded that lens information into the RAW file itself, so you can use that profile. Now, with that profile, it will do some chromatic aberration if we ask it to, or removal of chromatic aberration if we ask it to. If we're shooting at a narrow aperture, so for f8 and beyond, really, so f11, f16, and so on, you might find there's diffraction in your image, in which case diffraction correction can help. In images which are shot with a wide aperture, so this one is 4.5, it tells us that down the bottom, we don't really need to worry about it too much. The golden rule with every single tool in Capture One, and we talk about this quite a lot, is only use the tool if you have to. Every single button, imagine every button, every slider, every time you change something, you're risking damaging the image. So use the least amount of sliders and tools possible to get the exact result that you want. That's the golden rule, so try and stick with that one. So with our lens profile loaded in, and you can see it's done a distortion correction. So if I zoom out and undo that distortion correction, we can see it's actually effectively punched the image a little bit. because Capture One knows from that manufacturer profile that was embedded in the RAW that this lens has a bit of a barrel effect, so it fixes that right up. If we don't want that, we can undo it. What we also might find as a result of that is it's cropped in a little bit. So my crop tool up here on the top, it's showing a little bit of a dark area around the outside. That's where, as a result of that distortion correction, we've lost some of the image. So if you're less worried about distortion and more worried about getting everything in the frame that you captured, then it might be worth going into the crop tool, and you can always extend. Oops, let's just make sure I've got the right crop ratio on, so let's go to original. But I can extend up and include the distorted areas. But Capture One has said in this case, actually, no, we think actually you're better off with this crop based on that distortion correction. So we're going to leave this as is. Okay, next up, we're going to talk about this in a file later on as well. Curve. So we talk about this quite a lot, the difference between the auto curve and the linear response curve. So the auto curve builds in effectively into your histogram a little bit of a pop. It's going to make the shadows a bit darker, the highlights a bit lighter, and it's going to effectively give it that vividness that we like visually. And it looks a bit more appealing. But it's not really that close. Well, it's close, but it's not really aligned with the actual raw data that the camera was able to capture. That's most closely aligned to linear response, which is more of a direct line rather than a curve. So in this case, we're actually fine with auto. It's done a pretty good job. If I was seeing really overblown highlights or really underdone shadows, the first thing I would have a look at doing is using the linear response curve instead. Now, just bear in mind that by doing that, you're generating yourself a little bit of work, because to get that pop back, you're going to have to do a few more things with a few more sliders. But if you're going from a place where these items or elements of the image are already overdone, they're overblown, they're under exposed in the shadows, it might be worth starting from that, so you've got all the data there to start with, and then playing with it a little bit. In this case, we're going to leave it on auto. It's got the colors right, looks pretty good. So let's move on to our most used tab. This is where we spend most of our time in Capture One, which is the exposure tab, the one that looks like a histogram. Chili's just asked, so lens profiles. I've been shooting a lot with mirrorless and using the vintage lenses. Is there any chance Capture One will expand their lens profiles to at least the popular vintage? So I'm going to be honest. Chances are the full lens profile, I would doubt it, to be honest. It's a volume game. What they've got, and if you think about the work that goes into a true lens correction profile, you know, we're not just talking about they load the lens in, look at some mathematical tables, and then apply it. These lenses are brought into a lab. They're photographed in all the different aperture ratings against light, against dark, and so on. And they create profiles of that actual lens and how it behaves in different circumstances. It just doesn't make sense to do that for niche lenses. Yes, they may be popular, but it's a numbers game, unfortunately. Now, that said, I don't know what's going to happen in the future, but, you know, the ability to create your own profiles, a lot of people are asking for that. So if that's something that you want, put it in as a feature request. The more people that request a feature, so that's support.capture1.com, go there and put it in. It's not just for bugs. It's for things I'd like. So consider putting in a feature request for, you know, can I make my own lens profile, or is there a way of improving the generic list of lenses? Because at the moment you only have two. You have generic and you have generic pincushion. So maybe there are a few other ones, you know, generic ultra wide or something like that. I don't know, but it is genuinely worth putting this stuff in as requests. If they don't get the request, then they don't think there's a volume of people that want it. Okay, so what do we want to do with this image? Well, it's nicely framed, but I personally would like it to be a little bit neater. And by neater, I'm referring to these trees down here. Now, in the spirit of looking after our planet, I'm not going to suggest that we chop them all down. It's probably a bit easier for me to use the crop tool and come into there. Now, that does two things to me visually. So what I'm going to actually do is clone this variant and just reset it so we can see side by side. So here's our original on the right, and here's the new crop on the left. If I look at the lines that are going up, in this one, it feels quite bottom heavy. So we've got a lot of detail down the bottom, a lot of color down the bottom, and this line sort of starts from almost sort of 40% up and goes right up to this top corner. In our new crop, well, we've just come in a bit tighter and we've evened up these diagonals. So this diagonal now goes from here up to here. This feels nice and even with that banding. So just by coming in a tiny bit, we can actually make a big difference to how this photograph feels to the viewer. I'm even going to come in a little bit more just to drop that bottom tree. And then let's have a look at the way that we want to fill in these layers, because actually what this image is all about is layers. We've got an autumnal set of trees in the front, we've got this misty layer of trees in the background, then we've got full-on thick fog in the far distance. John's just asked on lens stuff, so if you've got questions, put them into the comments, we'll try and pick them up as we can. So how much deviation is there between your copy of the lens and the profile? There is copy variation, absolutely. So generally speaking, the higher, it sounds horrible, but the more expensive your lens, the likelihood is that it's closer to the original. There's going to be a tighter tolerance in those lenses themselves. The cheaper end of the market, so you know, if you think in Canon terms, the non-L lenses tend to have a lot wider variation. That's how they're cheaper, because the deviation can be greater. When it comes to chromatic aberration, which is one of the worst bits that we see in a lens, that's one of the reasons why I always tell people to do this analyze thing. Even if your lens has been picked up automatically and chromatic aberration has been applied based on the lens profile, I would always do the analyze thing on here, which is asking Capture One to analyze for any aberrations that occurred in your lens, on your sensor, on your camera, rather than the stock one that that was used. Pardon me. Okay, so let's have a little look at these layers. Now, first thing is we want to keep all the richness of color in the front. So let's put in a little graduated filter. So a gradient filter is this one down here, little dark to light, little square. When I draw the first graduated filter, it's going to create a new layer automatically for me. Just be very careful. If I go to draw another gradient, it's going to replace my gradient on this layer with this one. So on each layer, you can only have one gradient. And the first is automatic, the creation of the layer. From that point, you have to create your own layers for each gradient. So I'm just aligning to the trees on there. I'm going to press M on the keyboard to turn the mask off so I can see what's going on behind it. And with these trees, well, A, let's pull up a little bit of clarity. So that makes them pop a little bit. It separates out some of the trees from each other. We could, let's just zoom into 100% and see. There's quite a lot of detail in here. If I push structure too far, we're going to over sharpen the image. It's going to look horrible. So let's try and pull this down a little bit, but just give it a bit of a pop just to separate out some of these tiny little branches when it's printed. Okay, so that gives us a bit of a boost in the foreground. We might, so it's a question, but we might want to go to our color editor, and I'm going to go to advanced. I'm going to click on this little picker here and choose maybe this orange tone. Now I'm going to stretch it to get everything that's left and right of that orange tone as well. And with that tone, I'm just going to darken them a little bit. So by darkening them, we actually have the effect of increasing their saturation a touch as well without actually increasing the saturation. So consider doing that effectively by, instead of pushing your saturation way, way up, by pulling down the lightness of one particular color, it tends to have the effect of enriching it. Now, that means that you're losing some brightness, for sure. But in this case, I'm happy with that because it's just muted those trees, but it's brought out a bit more color and it allows me to push saturation a little bit more. Right, so that's this front level. Now, what about this middle level? Well, we're going to come back to that last because the first thing I want to do before we attack that one, let's call this layer trees, foreground. So double click on a layer name to call it something else. Call this one sky, and with our sky, another gradient, so another layer, and again press M on your keyboard for seeing the mask and M to make it disappear. So we've got a mask now that's affecting everything up here and nothing down here. So let's see what we can pull up. First off, let's add a lot of clarity in there. Now clarity, I often say to people, and we will see it in other videos, don't overdo clarity. And now you've just seen me whack in 87 on clarity. The reason is I'm not too worried about halos. I'm going to fix this up here in a second. If I was down here and I'd done that, you would see all these horrible halos and nasty artifacts that come as a result of too much clarity. But up in this sky area up here, we don't have really any detail. There's nothing that it can really base any haloing on. So what I'm also going to do is pull down our highlights a touch. Let's see what's in there. The whites, no, not much. What if we pull down our exposure? Well, there's not a huge amount up there, as you can see. So there's no point really in doing too much with this sky other than making it pop with a bit of clarity. So if I turn this layer off and turn it on again, we don't want the sky looking gray. So let's not do that exposure change by that much. But we do want that texture back. So we've got some texture up here, good texture up here. We've got a bit of haloing up here. So how can we fix that? Well, I'm going to right click on the layer and say rasterize the mask. Now that means that we're going to take it away from being a gradient and now it's paintable. So I can choose my eraser tool here. I can make the size nice and big and I can just erase the mask from there. And if I want to blend it in, which I do, we're going to use a lower opacity eraser, which allows me with every click to smoothly blend in where the mask is going to begin and where it's going to end. So that's our sky now a little bit more detailed, a little bit more texture in this, certainly in the top left and definitely down here. So now we've got our midpoint to play with. Let's have another little look on here. So let's call it midground. And on this one, instead of all of the normal gradient masks that we often use, I've kind of got two choices. I can do it with a radial mask. I can do it the lazy way, but actually it's just easier. Oops, let's put my opacity all the way up. It's just easier to draw this in. Now, I'm being pretty messy around this mask. Don't worry too much about that. And one of the things, so a lot of people have had questions about the way that we deal with layers and masks and opacities and so on. Now, what I can do now, I'm just going to go back to my brush and put in a much lower opacity. And I'm just going to go over those edges with a lower opacity. And this has the effect of feathering. Now, I can do it with a mask refinement, but it takes longer than just doing this, to be honest. So I'm just going to then feather that mask in. Now, if I look at this mask in grayscale, we can see we've got this sort of feather in at the edges. So it's not going to be a direct line that we see where the mask begins. Let's just turn off our mask again. And with that in the background, what we're going to do again is pull up some clarity, not a lot, pull up a bit of structure. And in this case, we're going to actually darken down the shadows. Now, these bits here, the temptation is to think they're in the highlights. But if I move my mouse over here, we can see that actually these areas here sit in this area. So they're definitely in the shadow area of the histogram. As I move my mouse around, you see the orange bar moving around there. So if I start playing with highlights, all I'm going to affect is that fog, which is actually going to make things a little bit weird. I want to pull down the shadows just to get some depth into here. Now, on top of that, rare departure, I'm going to use the contrast tool. The reason I'm going to use the contrast tool is if I look at this area here, I've got things to the left of the midpoint. We can see up in the histogram here. And I've got things to the right of the midpoint. Now, the contrast tool, again, it's that sort of relatively blunt instrument, and it's going to stretch that out, but only on this layer. So as I do that, we're going to get a bit more definition again. And on top of that, we could then, if we wanted to, pull down our saturation a touch. So there are two ways of making these colors stand out. One, we make them more saturated. Two, which is probably more natural, is we desaturate other areas of the image which aren't as key to these colors. In this case, that's going to feel more natural than pushing that too far. Now, again, up here in the mountain, I can see with my mask, we've got a little bit of an issue with our clarity up here, the that movement, or the halo, that's what we're talking about. So I'm going to just remove that halo up in the top right hand side. So I've got a mask here, and with that mask, we're just going to remove that out. Now, again, to feather that out, I can use a lower opacity so we don't notice this quite so much. And I'm also aware that I'm going to lose the effect that I had on this top part of the mountain. Now, that's fine by me. If you didn't want to, we could do this a lot more cleanly right up into that top corner. Of course, if we wanted to then think, oh, actually, I did it too much. Well, we can use our brush tool, so B on the keyboard, and we can brush some bits in. But just be careful. The second, with this much clarity on, you get near to the edge of that rock, you're going to start introducing some halos, which you don't want. Okay. Where are we? A couple of questions. So Claudio said, would you not want to add the clarity mask over the top right corner cloud covering the mountains? This one up here. We can do, I mean, we've got a bit of clarity. So we've got 37 on there. On this sky bit, we're up at 87, a crazy amount. I wouldn't suggest putting that on there. More than that on here, we're going to introduce some more halos around these trees. I don't think we want to pull it in anymore. And up here in this top right specifically, I'm a bit concerned because if I pull this down, let's just, my mask does cover here. If I pull this exposure down, which is always the quick guide, there's no real detail in there to pull out. So clarity can pull out loads and loads of detail if it's there in the first place. If it's not, it's not going to invent detail. So I think it's probably safe to say that's the best we're going to get out of that top right. And then Carlos just asked, would you use levels for contrast? Yes. So with all this done, let's look at our histogram here. So we've got huge amounts of space to the right, huge amounts of space to the left, which tells me we can afford to stretch this. Before we do that, I'm going to clone this variant just in case I don't like what we do. So for completeness and just from a logical point of view, I would always put levels on a top layer that's filled. So if I press M, we can see everything is filled. And we can go down to our levels tool. And now levels, remember, allows us to stretch that histogram out. So at the moment, our shadows are not really down here at 0 out of 255. They're up at sort of, where are we? Let's try and find something pretty dark. So we're at the sort of 40 to 50 mark according to these numbers up here. And our highlights, even though they look bright, actually, they're not actually up at the 250 mark. They're at sort of 200, something like that, pretty safe. So let's have a little look at what we could do by stretching that histogram. So we're bringing everything that was bright now to be a complete highlight, and everything that was dark now to be a complete dark area. The problem with this, and I'm hoping you can see it on the screens, is we've lost that feel of murkiness and fogginess and everything like that. Because remember, whenever you use levels to increase contrast, well, fog decreases contrast. So if we want to see fog, it doesn't make sense necessarily to stretch those levels too much because we get rid of the effect of the fog. So let's just have a look at pulling this back a little bit. So yes, we can use levels. Yes, we can increase our contrast in the overall image, but I wouldn't increase it that much. Certainly, it's nicer to be a little bit more vivid and vibrant than this version, but I wouldn't push it too much further than that. Where are we? Earl's just said, I think it's a little weird that the birches in the background are grey. So to be honest, they're not that much greyer than where they were before. So what you had before wasn't actually the colour of the birches. It was actually a bit of a colour cast coming from some of the haze. Wouldn't it be cool if there was a dehaze tool and capture one that was really quick? I'm joking. So we can do this through a curve. And we can get rid of some of that through the blue channel. So if I went onto our blue channel, oops, let's just make sure my curve's visible. I can see here we've got some extra blue stuff up here in the bright tones, and a huge amount of blue down here in the shadows, which is probably coming from this. If we did a curve adjustment, we could get rid of that haze, and what you'd be left with is pretty much that, which is why I use the saturation tool to do it. So just be careful that what you're seeing isn't necessarily the color of the tree, because if I look at that tree. 55, 72, I'm looking at these numbers at the top, by the way. So as I move my mouse over this tree on the original, 55, 56, 71, 101, it's heavily skewed towards blue. I could fix that by skewing our entire white balance to be warmer, but then weird stuff happens down here with these trees. And actually, it's funny, I kind of like the little bit of movement, but maybe not by quite so much. So maybe we do pull it up a touch just to there. That sort of works. Okay, so in my head, this then feels just a touch more vibrant, a little bit more rich than our original here. And that crop really makes a big difference. These trees down here are important to the scene. They were there, I get it. But in terms of something that I put on a wall as a print, that just feels a bit more finished because of the way that the lines fall, the way that it's constructed as an overall composition. Been to review one, catch you 121, getting a dehaze slider. Yes, it is getting a dehaze slider. If you have a look at the sneak peek number two, you will see David and I talking about the dehaze slider. And yes, as a starter for 10, as a way of getting rid of quick bits of haze, it's a great new addition. Use it at will. But for some of this intricate stuff, you might find that the curves are going to give you a better result. Pascal's just asked, would it be great if we were able to start typing a name for a layer as soon as you click the plus sign without having to double click? It would, Pascal. So when I do, but what I can do, when I click the plus sign, you hit enter, and then you can start typing. So it's not too much of a problem, but it would be good if it was there. But then if they did that, to be honest, half of the user base would then say, oh, I hate it that when you create a new layer, the first thing I've got to do is give it a name. So you never win. I'm not saying I want it. There'll always be a mix with the choice on Dehaze. Okay, let's move on then, just for fun, before we're going to come back to one of Ernst's shots later on. HDR. So, I went out the other day and just shot some random rubbish, just so that we could play with some HDR setups. So, in broad terms, we obviously have in Capture One the ability in our HDR sliders. So I'm just going to clone this variant before we get going. The ability in our HDR sliders to lower down highlights, lower down whites, bring up shadows, bring up black. Oops, I'm on a layer. That was silly. Let's go to the background. Lower down highlights, lower down whites, bring up shadows, bring up black. And we can see the whole scene in effectively HDR. So Randall, just before we get going, just to answer your question, how do you keep the histogram and layers up? So on all of your tools, this applies to any tool you have, these three little dots here, if I click on those dots, I can choose to move it to the pinned area. That means it stays at the top above this dark black line. Everything that's below this line is scrollable. Everything above here never moves. Try not to fill your pinned area with too much stuff, otherwise you're going to have a really small space to play with your other tools. But if you want to add another tool, right click on anywhere in your panel and you can go to add tool and choose. Remove tools, the same thing. Same with the tabs, you can add tool tabs and you can add and you can remove them as well. But if I wanted to move, for example, white balance up to the top, move to pinned area, that now stays where it is and everything else scrolls. If I don't want that, then I can say move tool to scrollable area and it will move down. Now be careful because it will move down to the very bottom, first of all. Just be careful that you don't move it in the wrong place. You can do it by dragging as well. So I can literally, as I just did, I can drag that white balance up to the top or drag it down to the bottom of the pinned area or into the scrollable area. Either way, so you just drag it. Right. So this is what we familiarize ourselves with in terms of HDR in Capture One. So in other words, highlight recovery, white recovery, shadow recovery, and black recovery. Wonderful. But there are limitations to what your camera can capture. So what I'm relying on here is, frankly, the dynamic range that my camera has in camera. And that's, you'll hear it referred to in the number of stops. So some cameras range from 11 stops of range, from 12 to 13 to 14 to 15. And in some cases, funnily enough, with the XT and something called Dual Exposure Plus, we can get up to 16 stops of dynamic range, which is huge. It doesn't mean you're going to see that immediately in the raw. It means that you've got all of this room to pull back shadows and pull back highlights and so on and see it. And it gives you a relatively rounded image. If you do it too much, yuck, we go into cartoon mode. Of course, we can pull down some exposure. But the effect is that everything is flattened. We lose all the contrast in the image. So what you can do instead, and as a lot of people have asked for, for us to go through, is shoot three or more. In fact, you don't even need to do that. You can do two shots. You can even do it through raw processing, but you can shoot three or more bracketed shots. So one mid-ground or midpoint, which is very difficult to do at sunrise, just for clarity. So one that captures basically the highlights and the shadows. So some of the highlights, some of the shadows, but the midpoint. Then you shoot one that's underexposed. Now the underexposed one has got all the information that was missing from the middle exposure in our highlights, so in this case, the sun. And then we shoot one that is overexposed. So in other words, everything that's a highlight is going to be completely blown out, but everything that was a shadow, we can now see in detail where I couldn't see it in the midpoint one there. So there's our midpoint. Here's all the detail by overexposing that shot. Now what Capture One doesn't do is something called exposure blending. So while we can take this middle ground shot, and as I just did, we can move those sliders to get the most out of the dynamic range in the raw, if something is beyond that dynamic range, then I would need to take bracketed shots to capture the highlights, capture the shadows, and we need a tool to bring them together. So let's pick on these three and let's round trip them. So by round trip, what we're referring to is come out of Capture One with some edited files, do some changes, and then send them back into Capture One as a completed file. So that you can see everything that is happening, let's just, what we're going to do is hide the viewer so you can see up here. Right click, and we're going to go to Edit With. Now, in this case, for today, we're going to use Photomatix Pro. So Photomatix Pro have written a plugin. I literally have the trial version I put on here the other day. I was talking to David about it, so we've put it on. We're going to have a little play with it live now. But let's just have a look at what we can do with it. Sorry, I was just seeing Randall's comment. I understand that, Paul, but those two windows will not display simultaneously for me. Then I'm mystified as well, Randall, to be honest. Is it something where you've got too big of a pinned area, or I don't know, one thing to test or one thing to try, see if it's something about that tool tab. So go on to another tool tab and try and do the same thing and see if it works on a different tab. And then just, yeah, have a play, let me know. We can have a look, but if Capture One support are already on it, it may be that they're trying to replicate it too. Okay, so to get these three shots into one merged, we're going to go to Edit With. We don't export, we don't open with, we edit with. And we're going to go into Photomatix Pro. Before we actually go into that program, I'm just going to cover a couple of, let's call it, gotchas that happen with this. Remember that your export into Photomatix is going to effectively blend the highlights, the shadows, and the midtones together in the best way. If you have already done that by pulling down highlights, pulling down whites, pulling up shadows, pulling up blacks, you are going to end up with a very, very, very fake looking HDR image. Now, from a personal point of view, I'm not a huge fan of the HDR look, but if you do this correctly, what you should be doing is all of your lens corrections in Capture One, any color corrections in Capture One, and any exposure adjustments, including any layers that you want to do in Capture One. Clarity, potentially, and I would consider doing that in Capture One, but if you're going to create any layers, so any healing layers, in this case I had a person down here, so that heal layer exists in every single one of them, so I've copied the adjustments from one to all of the other layers. So we're going to make sure that each of, all of the layers, all the other images, we need to make sure that each image is consistent in the way that's applied all those adjustments. Otherwise, you're going to confuse that Photomatix plugin no end. So let's turn off our viewer again so you can see the menu system. So three images together and right click, edit with, merge to HDR with Photomatix Pro. Be careful with this because normally we'd go into like a basic tab and it would talk about the output here, which is still here. But this one that's presented here, the Photomatix Pro one, is actually the input back into Capture One that you're controlling. So how do you want it called? In this case, we're going to say you want it to join up all the file names. So it's going to say 2307, 2308, 2309 as a file name. Or do you just want the first name of the, or the file name of the first photo? In this case, we'll combine them. I can put a suffix and say HDR if I want to. And we can choose a format. So 16-bit, 8-bit JPEG, you would normally use 16-bit TIFF in this case. Now, when I go to the basic tab, these are the settings about how I'm exporting the image from Capture One. So it's this setup here that controls what Photomatix receives, not what it sends back. So in this case, a TIFF that's 16-bit, for the purposes of speed, I'm going to reduce this to 50% just because there are 150 megapixel images. And I choose my ICC profile here. Photomatix is going to take the profile that you send in, so make sure you get this right as well. So we're going to click on Edit Variants. Capture One is going to load up. There we go, a little activity that prepares the images. So this is Capture One creating those three variants from each of those images. And those variants are based on being 16-bit TIFFs at 50% size with Adobe RGB as the ICC. Just one question to answer. So, Ernst, any way to stitch with Photoshop in this method? No. Short answer, no. Photomatix is the HDR merging and so on, and that's it. Claudius just said about what criteria you use to decide to use Luma curves instead of the RGB curve. We'll cover it in another session, to be honest, Claudio. It's based on, in my view, how aligned those curves are. So whether I'm adjusting simply the brightness of things, or whether I'm adjusting the colors as well as the brightness. But we'll cover it in an image a bit later on. Well, possibly not this session, maybe next one. So you can see here, we're on a trial version of Photomatix. So merge to HDR options. You're gonna get these windows that are basically a wizard as we go through. So the first question you're gonna answer is, do you want it to align source images? Now, if you've taken your shots handheld, you're going to need to do this, because even tiny little adjustments are going to have a big impact. However, very rarely are you doing bracketing exposures handheld. Now, this risks any movement that... So if Photomatix sees something that's different, imagine we've got some branches moving in the foreground or something like that. There is a risk that it tries to align the image to match those branches. So consider this one. If you are going to, then you can set the tripod preset if you want and tell it to crop if it has to move stuff around. But with this shot, because I know there was no movement whatsoever, I don't need to have this enabled. We've got a ghosting option. We'll talk about that in a second. And you've got this option here, which is to be able to get the lowest exposed image. So in other words, the image with all of the shadow stuff in it, to have some noise reduction. Now, here's the debate again. Do you want to do your noise reduction in Capture One from the RAW processor, or do you want to do it within Photomatix? I've played with this so far. To be honest, the results are pretty similar from both, so I wouldn't worry about it too much. But what I would do is make sure it's only doing it on the underexposed image. Don't worry about doing it on the other ones, because in theory, they should be correctly exposed with very little noise anyway. Now, reduce chromatic aberrations. Capture One is going to do that better for your lens than Photomatix is going to do, so I would leave that off and just make sure, again, you've done your lens correction and your chromatic aberration and distortion and purple fringing and all the other things, A, in Capture One, and B, for every single shot in exactly the same way. Okay, so let's move on to deghosting options. So a ghost happens. When you have an object or a person or something like that that's moving in between brackets. So let's imagine a person's walking through the street and they're there in one image and they're blurred. So in the short image, so the fast exposure, they're there nice and sharp. In the middle exposure, they're a little bit more blurred. In the longer exposure, they are just a haze or a mist in there. With ghosting options, what we can actually do, well, number one, we can automatically do it. But number two, let's imagine I had a person here. Well, I can draw this area here and say this particular area, I want to deghost. So in other words, I want to remove anything that changes between the different frames and keep something that's only static. Now, in terms of landscape stuff, to be honest, again, you're probably not going to need it. If you did, we can try with automatic. But what I have found is, and I'll show you on the wave one later on, deghosting actually, especially with water and skies and clouds and stuff like that, can produce some pretty weird effects. So I would leave this off if I were you, from a landscape point of view. And in here, we tell it what the base photo is. So in other words, if you've got some differences between the underexposed and the overexposed, and they can't decide between them, then go to the base image that you've selected here, because that's the correct one in terms of deghosting. So in this case, we're going to go automatic, but none, because I'm going to choose none. And go to OK. So now what it's doing is it's merging those images to HDR. And I'm just going to make this window a little bit smaller so you can see what it's done. And I'm also going to make this preview window a little bit smaller so you can see what it's done. So the preview is pretty horrible. But that's because we haven't actually tweaked any settings. So in here, you've got a load of built-in settings that come with Photomatix and all the other HDR processors that are out there. I've seen it have the same sort of thing. I'm just going to zoom to fit there. Cool. So we can see the scene. Now, this is set as natural and it's using this fusion HDR method. So there's two ways of doing the HDR blending. One is through tones and contrast. The other is through what they call fusion. For landscape stuff, typically fusion is going to be a bit better. To give you an example, this is a detail enhancer.
Wow.
Which is where, and you can see that Topaz does a similar thing to this. You can have this thing called Detail Enhancer, which brings out all the details and everything like that, but at a cost of hurting your eyes. Of course, you have the sliders down here, so we can reduce the strength of it. We can change some of the amount that. So, tone compression basically squishes or it stretches the tone. So, if we want it to be more stretched, then great. We can add a bit more contrast in the details. So, in other words, we can get back to something that looks a bit more natural, but they've already done that for you in here. So, you've got in here realistic. So, realistic is using a tone balancer rather than contrast based. And it's not, it's all the boost stuff is turned off, so it's not doing any brightness boosting, it's not doing any extra contrast like this. It's keeping it as natural as it possibly can. Photographic. This is again, where were we at? Realistic before. Photographic is probably a bit more subtle, so especially if you look around this sun area here, that's the area with our realistic quote. This is the one with the photographic quote, but I then come to natural because natural seems to be the best mix or the best blend, excuse the pun, to get back to something that looks photographically real. Now, of course, we can still play with some of these sliders. So we can increase the strength of the blend. We can also add in extra local contrast down here. We can allow the highlights to go a little bit brighter. We can allow the shadows. Let me just stretch the window so you can see a bit better. We can allow the shadows to go a bit darker if we want to. So in other words, don't use as much from the highlighted image in the shadows. And we can choose to blend with our base image. So let me just pull this back up so you can see. So our blending here, we can choose either use the dark photo or the bright photo or the baseline, the mid-tone photo. And at the moment, it's using a blend of all three images. Well, I can say actually use more of that base photo, please, if I choose. Great. I can increase saturation. We've got limited room to increase temperature here. You're better off doing that in Capture One beforehand. And of course, we can bring brightness up if we want. So with that done, and I'm sort of sat thinking, okay, that's okay. It's done not a bad job, in fairness. We go to finish, and finish is going to pop up. So it's going to fuse the images with my settings. And then we're going to put, hopefully, and where are we? Sorry, I just got a bit sidetracked here, sidelined by Claudia's statement. You know, when you're talking to someone who's got a big zit in their face, I can't focus with that lens flare on the left. Yes, Claudia, so I'm going to show you something in a minute that will make you feel better. But yes, I know what you mean. It upsets me. So, when you're finished in this process, the last thing, and you can turn this off, on or off if you want. So at the moment, it's defaulted as on, what they call finishing touches. So you can add in an extra little contrast boost. You can add in some extra sharpening. You can recrop the image if you want. You can straighten the image. And this is about the final image. But let's say I'm just going to leave it as it was. Go to save and re-import. And it's going to bring that in as a TIFF there in my browser. Wonderful. So let's just go back to show my viewer. And because this is a demo version, it's got its watermark all over it, so fine. So here is our blended HDR version of that shot. Now that's a round trip in Photomatix. So that is literally create your three variants, right click, edit with. You'll get that pop-up up. You can choose how you want Photomatix to bring it back into Capture One, but more importantly, how you want to send the variants into Capture One. Do your tweaking in Photomatix, hit finish, and then it comes back in. But here's the thing. I'm just going to drag this thing that's just done. So this was live, you just saw it being created there. Here's the other photo I took that morning. So this is frame averaged, granted, so it's a longer exposure than the other ones. But this is an image which has had slight pulling on the sliders, and frankly, it just feels a bit more natural. It hasn't got that harshness of tone. So if I go into our HDR version, to be honest, it's done a good job. I don't mind this at all, but the work to get to that and the risk, because I've got this weird sort of halo line around here on the sun. There's stuff going up here with the cloud, which isn't quite right. So I'd have to delete some of that and go to a different exposure. Or I can just take one single shot and I can pull up some of the shadows and some of the highlights, pull it down. It's natural to have a sun that is, you know, I'm shooting into the sun. It makes sense. And with that long exposure, Claudio, you'll be pleased to know that you can also hide from that flare by having seen it in a previous one and being able to get rid of it with a little bit of trickery. So effectively, yes, Photomatix gives you a great way of round tripping from Capture One into an HDR merging piece of software and back out again as whatever format you choose. My challenge is I'm not seeing anything in there that I couldn't do with some properly processed imaging anyway. Now, where we get ghost problems, and this is a pretty difficult scene for Photomatix, so let's just edit with Photomatix Pro again. Same thing, so 50% size, come back in as a 16-bit TIFF. Now, in this case, we've got clouds that are moving. We've got water that's moving. We've got a rock that's not. So, and actually, this is a good example of where you do need potentially a bit of bracketing, because we've got some challenges with what's in the shadows, and they're deep shadows in this rock, and what's in the highlights, which is the sky. Don't need to do a lining, don't need to worry about any of this stuff, so let's go into deghosting. Now, in this case, even I had a bit of a challenge when I was trying to work out how we're going to do this, because, you know, for instance, up here in the sky, I know this cloud moves, so let's do it without the deghosting. I know this cloud moves quite a bit. We're going to go with automatic and allow it to do some mild deghosting for us. Okay. So detecting ghosts sound very ominous. So it's going to merge that image. We're going to probably get the big screen again, so I'll try and minimize it down so you can see. Come on, there we go. So there's our horrible version in the background that you just saw the preview of. Let's make this a bit smaller so we can see it. And the same with this one. So this is Photomatix actual base image that we're playing with, but these are the settings that we're going to choose. So again, we can choose photographic, we can choose natural. Natural's done a pretty good job. We've got some weird, and on the up close versions, you're gonna have to take my word for this, but we've got some weird stuff going on every now and then in the sky over here, where we've got these sort of duplicates where the sky was moving. So you see this bit here is duplicated from there to there. This bit is duplicated from there to there when it wasn't like that. Funnily enough, randomly, I got a couple of duplicated dust spots and stuff like that. But we could paint and blend and fix it and so on in Photomatix, and it would do a pretty good job. We're going to go to finish. Ignore this horrible preview. Let's have a little look what we can get. So fusing those images, wonderful. I'm not worried about contrast, so save and re-import. And we get this shot, which is actually pretty good. But here's the thing. I still don't have all of my shadows back. I certainly don't have them back to the level of my original shadows exposure. So some of this comes down to the tweaks that you make in the slider in Photomatix. You're going to have to get pretty good with those sliders. You're going to have to get pretty good with checking out ghosts and blending and making sure that, for instance, the sea looks natural. Because if I look at the way that it's done it, it's just taken it from this base image and pretty much lifted it. It hasn't taken much from here. And I still come back to that same thing of, if I took this image here and I were to try and use just some basic pull-down highlights, certainly pull down whites for this sky, but let's pull up the blacks area, pull up the shadows area here. I'm actually going to do a little bit of a there as well onto these rocks. So there's our HDR blend, and there's our single shot with the shadows recovered, with the highlights recovered, and so on. Personally, I don't like the way that this looks. I think it's overdone. This one's probably, ironically, a bit more natural, but I haven't got the benefit of seeing all the detail in the shadows anyway. So I guess with this, what I'm saying is, effectively, there is no difference in my mind to the amount of care you're going to need to take in Capture One to get an image to look right. You're going to have that same mindset in something like Photomatix or Affinity that also does blending of HDR photos as well, and other tools that are out there. You know, there are many out there that do it. But just because it's a tool that suggests that it can be done automatically, the nuances are what make the image look realistic. And it's that amount of care that you're going to have to take to make this look really, really real. And I still come back to that point of, to me, this I know was a single shot image. This is a real exposure. I haven't had to worry about ghosting. I haven't had to worry about issues with repetition or issues where it's picked up the wrong exposure for my exposure and so on, because it's all one shot. What I have done is absolutely recovered some of the detail, but it's certainly a way of doing things, but just be really careful not to overdo it. And certainly don't go into Photomatix and use those detail enhancers and cartoon effects and whatever else. So some questions that are in there. I don't like none of them. Sorry about that. So David's saying, I've always had trouble getting a realistic transition on the windowsill between the interior. Yeah, I've seen the same, David, to be honest, between the interior shot and the outside. I mean, the argument, and this is actually one of the most fundamental arguments for using flash indoors when you, if you're shooting like hotels or real estate or whatever, there's a reason a lot of people use flash on the interior, because it allows me to balance out that scene and it then looks realistic because it was a single shot. You just got to balance the white balance in the flash as well. But yeah, in HDR terms, to be honest, tools like Photomatix can do a really good job of it, but it takes a lot of tweaking to get it looking really, really right. So where else were we? Pascal, or you'd be amazed by the number of people that rave over the overdone cartoony in your eyes. Yeah, and I get it. As you're flicking, the interesting bit is, as you're flicking through a screen that's 1,000 pixels wide, these images capture the attention for sure. But they're just not doing it for me, especially when you start thinking about, well, I want to print this. I want to have it on a wall. I don't want my eyes to bleed every morning when I come down and see it. So Roger's saying it'd be nice to have something like Lightroom's file stacking group in the component images with the HDR version. Yeah, for those people that want to do HDR blending in Capture One, I do see the case for trying to get some sort of extension to the tools in Capture One that allow you to do some of these stacks. But at the moment, and you've just seen it there, to be honest, Photomatix have been doing this for a long time, and the good news is they've got the ability to tweak all of those different settings. But even their settings that they've had all that time to work on, they still need changing, they still need tweaking. It's a bit like a style in Capture One. You don't just click the style and run because it's done. We actually use that style as a base point, and then you build on it to get your own style from it. And the same with these tools. So, you know, I'm trying to make sure that people aren't of this impression that you click the button and Photomatix makes your image perfect. Same with Affinity, same with all the other stuff that's out there. You're going to need to learn those tools just as much as you do Capture One or whatever else you're doing it with. Andy, if capturing with a more limited camera, there's the more chance the Photomatix result will create a more pleasing result. Yeah, there is. So if you're on a camera where you can't possibly get the highlights correct at the same time as the shadows and so on, then arguably using an HDR tool is going to get you a better result than not being able to at all. However, I would sort of be tempted to have, there's a bit of a mix between two answers here that two people have said. So one from John, why not use layers in Photoshop or Affinity to select different exposures and different parts of the image? Yep, good answer. So to me, the more natural blend tends to be where I've got an area which is slightly lighter, an area that's slightly darker, and use the precision movement of deleting the bits that you don't want or adding the bits that you do. And then, of course, the ultimate answer, a graduated filter and a longer exposure. Yeah, in my head, I like that shot. That feels like it felt at the time. It doesn't feel like it's digital in that sense. And digital's not a bad word. It's just, to me, that feels more organic. It feels more sunlit than the HDR version. So to me, I'm in a scene where I've got a very bright area at the top, a very dark area at the bottom. I'm going to use a graduated filter to try and balance those out. And then you get it. Jerry, so the power in Capture One is more than capable to get what you wanted when you took the shot. It is, but to Andy's point just now, it's going to get the best out of your camera. If your camera is limited in dynamic range, you've got a couple of choices. One, you can bracket the exposure. Two, you can buy a different camera. It's Christmas. And probably more realistic, if you're in a scene where you've got an unbalanced scene, so bright to dark, try and use a filter if you can. In the case of, I can't remember who asked it earlier, was it John or... David, sorry. In the case of real estate, that's a lot more difficult because you don't just have a bright area and a dark area. You've got bright areas through window frames, and the frames themselves are dark. then in that case, then using a tool like Photomatix is a great move because it helps do all of those adjustments for you. And it's going to be quicker than doing it in Photoshop yourself for sure. Where are we? Andy's off camera shopping. There we go. Cool. So that's effectively the round trip. So in essence, get your variants correct. So that's the first thing. Now, you can actually trick HDR tools a little bit. So we can take this mid exposure and I can create two variants. I can create, so even if I've only done one exposure, I can in theory create, let's do it. So let's just clone this a couple times. So this is my mid-tone, well, or my mid-exposure. Well, let's make a brighter exposure. Well, that's quite easy. I'm just going to go to the background and I'm going to lift that exposure. So there's my exposure for my shadows. Let's check that I haven't introduced too much noise. It's not too bad, a little bit too much, but fine. And then I can have another exposure for my shadows. So let's go to our background and pull that down. There's my shadow exposure. So I've now got three exposures. In three different variants from one actual exposure that was taken. Now, you're going to be limited by noise and by dynamic range of the camera, but you could take these three and send them into Photomatix or another HDR blend and get them pulled back as a single file, and it would do a similar job. But you're not getting quite the benefit of getting the true shadow exposure, the true highlight exposure, and the base one. What you would get the benefit of is no ghosting, because those images are exactly the same in terms of the content of them. But the round trip, the most important bit, as I say, when you go to edit with, this setting here is what the tool is coming back to capture one with, not what you're sending to it. What you're sending to it is in the basic tab here. And then obviously it brings it back into the catalog as one TIFF and you can have a look. Okay, or as Earl said, you can hire an editor and just outsource all that work to someone else that's willing to put up with the pain. So let's go back to our viewer. That's probably it for today. So I'm really sorry. We only got through one image, and two little HDR examples. But hopefully that helps with people's understanding of what we mean by round tripping and the plugin stuff. So you can, of course, do this with any other tool. You can just export those variants into TIFFs, you can pick up those files, you can bring them into another tool, blend them, and then send it back into the catalog manually. What the round trip ability enables you to do is do that automatically and have it automatically come into the catalog in one go as it stands. Next time, we're going to start probably with this shot from Kyrkotis, I think, which is a drone shot. We'll do a bit of drone editing with a DNG from a DJI drone, and then we'll pick up on some other ones too. So don't forget, for those of you that want to be nosy tomorrow, or if you've got nothing better to do, then certainly come and have a look at the setup that we've got. Earl's comment is still on our screen for some reason, so let's pop that off. So tomorrow at 10 a.m. UK time and 7 p.m. UK time, we've got those sessions with Drew at phase one. We're going to talk about not just the processing, well, in fact, hardly any of the processing, but actually how we're capturing images and the switch to XT. In the meantime, obviously, we can talk about all of this stuff on Facebook. So there's that Facebook group. There's quite a few of you in there now. Just bear in mind in that group, you're getting, well, what I'm seeing is great, actually. You're getting a lot of user help with people. Please don't forget, yes, I can take some of the stuff of that group and we can talk about support and we can try and help where we can. We can also talk about features in the future. But if you want a feature in Capture One, use that support.captureone.com site. Feature requests, supports, bugs, all the other stuff that goes with it. It's only there that actually gets into the queue so people can actually take notice of it and try and fix stuff. In the meantime, obviously, we have all of those YouTube videos for all the pro tip stuff. And don't forget to send in your images so that we can have a play with them together. So paulreefordlive.wetransfer.com, you upload the RAW file. So that's either the EIP or the original RAW file. The EIP allows me to see what adjustments you've already made. Send it in. We'll try and get through as many as we can. Hopefully next week it'll be a bit less focused on one particular tool. The good news this week is because apparently Thanksgiving isn't still happening, We haven't had that weird blip that we did last week with the video quality, so all good. Between now and then, so it'll be next week, next Thursday, 3 o'clock as normal. Stay safe. Go out if you're allowed to. Stay in if you're not allowed to. And we'll catch you in a week's time. Cheers, everyone. Bye.